Hotep, welcome to Trick City. Again, this is like the third false start. No, it's only the second. It's only the second start. The other one was a false start. It took us long enough to get started. But anyway, listen, I'm not going to waste too much time. I got some brothers here. They're going to give you a lot of information, so get your pads and pens ready so you can take down some information. You might have things you might need to look up or whatever. So we're going to have a lot of information. Believe me, a lot. So I'm serious. Take it down this time. Brother Michael, welcome to the show.
All right. Thank you, Michael.
Am I introduce you as Michael Jihad?
That'll be fine.
That's your name, Michael Jihad. You hear this brother beating up people on the radio, beating up Al Sharpton and other people on the radio. So you know who he is now. And Brother Robert X. These brothers are researchers. They give information, lectures, and I actually met them at a Steve Coakley lecture many years ago, and that's what it opened up my mind. Believe me, it was like taking the red pill in the Matrix. So I don't want to waste any time. I want you brothers to jump right into it. We're going to talk about politics, economics, things like that. So, Michael, you always been talking about how politics are pretty much a waste of time. And if you don't have any economics in order, you're not going to get any respect from politicians anyway, right?
Well, I mean, this is a capitalist system. And if, you know, you walking around thinking all you got to do is pull a ballot and you can make something happen, then you're just fooling yourself. No, you've got to have an economic base in place for electoral politics to serve you. And I'm not even certain if that would work at this particular point in time for black folks, even if we had some economics in place. I don't even know if it would still work because we've made so many mistakes. I, it's hard to say.
It's too late?
I think we're pretty close to being too late.
Oh, man, that's bad. We got
to. That's how I feel. I mean, if you look at the activity of black folks in this country, I mean, there's virtually no movement towards establishing anything that we control.
We so disjointed.
Yeah, everything we buy from somebody else. I mean, the Koreans control the black hair care industry. That says more than I think enough.
Okay, Brother Robert, go ahead. You all can jump in there. You all can get started and start talking. I can just shut up. Go ahead.
Well, you know, I couldn't add too much on to that other than, I tend to deal with the more structural aspects mm-hmm. of what's going on from the research standpoint. But just to add on to what Mike was saying, when you consider you got a group of people who have been given access to this country from across the border, mm-hmm. and you can see them already since that influx from across the border in the black community, cutting grass and selling that corn with the stuff on it. And you see black people lined up to buy this stuff, to buy corn with some stuff on it. I would like to use another word, but I'm not going to do it. But that shows you the level of disparity, and for that matter, unconscious thinking for a group of people who basically lived in abject poverty where they come from. I'm talking about the Mexicans, to come to this country and sell black people corn and are doing a brisk business. It kind of takes me back to Carter Woodson's book, The Miseducation of the Negro, when he busted out his brethren, the Boulay, when he wrote that book saying, all of you have all these educational degrees and other people are controlling your community. This was back in the 50s, okay? Here we are in 2012, right, and the situation has just accelerated. We got more college graduates standing in unemployment lines today than we ever have before.
And deeply in debt.
Yes. And that's because school, when you really look at it educationally, education is nothing more than another form of welfare. It primarily functions to keep the institutions of higher education going in this country. All the grants and these things that come from the government, that's nothing more than welfare at a different level. And seriously, it maintains the educational system in this country. You take those grants away, 3/4 of the universities in this country will probably have to close their doors, because most of the students who are going to these colleges go there because of these loans
and grants that they get from the federal government or that are backed by the federal government. So, but I think more than that, brother, we're on the edge of an entirely different genre in terms of the system of government and economics that are being played out right before our eyes. And I'm not even sure if black people are spectators in this, because most of us have no idea what's going on in terms of the overall restructuring of the entire society in this country and outside of it. So politics, we've tried to tell people, will cease to be a viable form of accomplishing anything in the very near future. Hmm. Electoral politics is already not viable. No one can show me anywhere where black people who have attained electoral position have been able to do anything outside of maintain a job for themselves and their close associates around them. When you look at the condition of black people all over this country, nothing, relatively speaking, has really changed in a positive manner for the vast majority of black people. And now we've got a black president who can't even say the word black people. So that lets you know that electoral politics cannot serve the interests of black people, period. It has nothing to do with what I think or what you think or what Jihad thinks. We merely have to look at the facts of the matter, and the facts of the matter bear what I just said out.
Plus, you notice that every election, people seem to lose more and more interest, and there's very few people voting. It's almost like when you had a ballot out, they might as well just have none of the above, because that's who most people are voting for, because they don't even go.
Absolutely.
It's like whether they realize it or not, it's not making a difference anyway, right?
That's right.
Right. So tell us who's really pulling the strings.
I don't know. we get in trouble sometimes when we say who we think are pulling the strings. Hmm. But I think members of the Jewish community are pulling the strings. They control the financial systems globally. And truth be told, it was a conspiracy via a Jewish-controlled financial interest that caused the real estate market to melt down. I mean, it was contrived to do that. It was a criminal act on the part of these people. Nobody went to jail. In fact, not only did no one go to jail, but they got $750 billion of taxpayers' money, plus they got the houses back. That's the best of both worlds.
Sure is.
So, what we have, in fact, is a criminal conspiracy between the Jewish-owned financial institutions and the people that those of you who voted for.
Again, I'm going to add on to what Mike just said. Institutionally, here's what I'd like for people to do. Go and look up the Bank of International Settlements. You hear people talking about the Federal Reserve. Well, the Federal Reserve is a bit player in this. There are central banks all over the planet, as Brother Mike said, primarily controlled by old money Jewish interests. The Bank of International Settlements, which is in Basel, Switzerland, they call it the Tower of Basel, after the Tower of Babel. Okay? That is the central bank of all the central banks. You can then look at the Group of 30. The Group of 30, not the G8 or the G12 or the G20 that's coming here later on this month, but the Group of 30. They are the people like Tim Geithner, who's a member of the Group of 30, who basically take that policy that comes from the Bank of International Settlement and gives it to the other central banks and people in high positions of finance. They then take that information to the United Nations, which is like the storehouse for all the governments on the planet. They get this information to the United Nations, who gives it to the various representatives, who take that information to their various countries to implement financial policy based on what the Bank of International Settlement and the Group of 30 have come up with. classic example is this new form of slavery called austerity. We were talking about austerity almost 3 years ago because we saw it as part of a global plank being put in place to destabilize the entire global economic system to bring about a certain result. We see austerity being put in place all over the planet, but no one understands and has been able or has been explained to the people that this is a policy that comes straight out of the United Nations by way of the Bank of International Settlements. So nobody knows who's sitting on the board of the Bank of International Settlements. I know. I'll tell you one person who's sitting on the Bank of International Settlements who's probably number three or number four in the entire structure. His name is Paul Volcker.
Yeah.
He came out with something called the Volcker Rules that Barack Obama is implementing. Okay? Now, these are supposed to be the rules laid down that govern the inner workings of the financial authority, right? But what it really is, it's the framework for the dilution and the reestablishment of a new, what they call, economic order, okay? This new economic order will require that people participate in what they term lifelong working, no more retirement.
Yeah.
If you collapse the economy, which is what we see going on before us now globally, and they can't fix it because the amount of derivatives are worth more than $750 trillion, that's with TR, dollars, which is more than the entire GDP of the whole planet. They did this purposely to push and put in place what they call global governance. Global governance. Notice, Brother Mike, they won't say global government. They say global governance because they know that people have equated global government with New World Order. So they use these words to, in fact, hide what they want to do.
Soften the blow.
Yes, sir. Mm-hmm. It's kind of like when you hear the word sustainable development or public-private partnership. We would think that these terms came from the world of academia, when in fact, those are part of an overall program being put in place through the UN and those institutions that I named earlier, Bank of International Settlements and the Group of 30, to in fact create one world government. The whole green movement and environmentalism. There's much, much more involved in this so-called green movement. You remember, I know y'all probably remember, Brother Mike, when Obama went to Copenhagen to the so-called Earth Summit. And there he was supposed to implement or begin the implementation once he came back of the system called cap and trade. I know most people probably forgotten that now.
Has something to do with carbon exhaust emissions?
That is correct. It's kind of like the fact that you got to go to the Secretary of State through one of their offices on an annual basis now to get your emissions checked, okay, which sends money to the state, right? But that's phony, too. They're saying us breathing is a hazard to the well-being of the planet. Too much consumption.
Too many of us.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because we emit carbon.
So reduce the population.
Absolutely. That's where they're heading here. Okay. And now they're openly talking about reducing the world's population because it's the people on the planet that's the problem, as opposed to the very few corporate people at the top of this thing who are really the problem with the people on the planet.
So when they reduce the numbers, what they're trying to get it down so that the 1% will have more breathing room, as you want to put it?
I guess you could say that, Mike.
Well, you know, I suffer from PTSD. Probably a lot of people don't know that. And one of the things that my psychiatrist talks about is that, and he's talking about Caucasians, he says that the only time that they feel comfortable is when they have more than they know is enough. enough is never enough for them. It always has to be much more than they will ever use, and that's the only time they feel comfortable. So that psychology works right into this.
So like, you know, the ultimate in capitalism. Huh?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'm going
to
give you.
They think they have the right to determine literally who lives and who dies. And I guess, you know, and if we don't put ourselves in a position to stop them from making that determination, they will.
Yeah.
I think it's important for people to understand things like Agenda 21. We were talking about this stuff over 20 years ago, sustainable development and all this kind of stuff. We were talking about this, and we literally laid out the program by which they were going to do the things that they're doing now. I didn't see the green movement, but we knew environmentalism was fake because we did the research going all the way back to the late 60s, early 70s. So when Obama went to Copenhagen, and at the time he went there, it was subsequently revealed that people inside of the environmental movement who were pro-environmentalism or pro-green movement, in fact, released information that showed that they were manipulating the data because they wanted to push environmentalism, which is, again, population control, okay? And all that stuff came out. Obama had to come back here after he went and got his Nobel Peace Prize because he couldn't push the thing based on all the information that was coming out saying the thing was phony. And, you know, again, it just validated the things that we have been reading going all the way back to the 60s with people like Paul Ehrlich, who wrote the book called The Population Bomb, okay, mm-hmm. where he was saying that if you don't reduce the world's population by a certain number at a certain point in time, there are going to be too few resources and too many people. So they come up with all these various summits now on an annual or semi-annual basis, like the Rio Summit, the Earth Summit, and all these various summits that they have to come up with new ways to push old lies, okay? So, I'll give you an example. Here's some articles, and I'm gonna pass them around once I hold them up, to show people that these people are so brazen, it's right in your face today, hidden in plain view. And this is from very mainstream media until I get to UN stuff, like the people and the planet. A summary and recommendations from April 2012, which is a PDF dealing with how they're going to reduce the numbers of people on the planet, okay? And they're so bold that they put it right in your face. They talk about the movement of people in terms of integration here, but what do they call it in Europe? They don't call it integration in Europe. What do they call it? Migration, like animals migrate annually. They came to the conclusion that that's a good way to control population because most of the people who migrate are the males. They leave the women behind. Therefore, the women can't have children, so we're going to encourage migration, okay? All that's right in their document. Here's what's interesting. They come out then and say things like this. This is from LifeSiteNews.com for March 25th, 2009. Reduce UK population by half, leading government green advisor says. Okay? Then we get things like global Great Depression and population reduction by 2030. Massachusetts Institute of Technology and Club of Rome prophecy. Now, for those of you who don't know, the Club of Rome is another organization founded by David Rockefeller in 1993, right alongside the Trilateral Commission. These things are no longer conspiratorial. They're real. He founded in Bellagio, Italy, okay? Bellagio, Italy. It has been about population reduction since its existence. So now here we are at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. They're working in conjunction with the Club of Rome to bring about public policy to, in fact, reduce the population by any means necessary. Then we get things like this. Secret globalist ties revealed. University of Oregon, Norgard, World Bank, and Agenda 21. So we see the universities participating in educating or
propagandizing to the students to, in fact, deal with population control. But you cannot use that phrase. A University of Texas professor, whose name escapes me, pointed out that when you're talking about these things, and they gave this guy the most prestigious award in the University of Texas. He said, when you're talking about population control, don't use that phrase because it has negative connotations to it. So pick out another phrase to say the exact same thing. In other words, subversion. So we can see the University of Oregon is pushing Agenda 21, which is all about population control, sustainable development, and the so-called green movement. And the last article I got on this is this one saying, cut world population and redistribute resources, expert urges. Nuclear disaster or plague likely unless population shrinks and natural resources are reassigned to poor, says Professor Paul Ehrlich. The same guy from the 1960s and 70s who wrote the population bomb, they went and dug this creature up to basically get him and put him on the front page of The Guardian, which is a British newspaper.
Prestigious newspaper, yeah. By the way.
April 26, 2012. All this is relatively recent, right in everybody's face, hidden in plain view.